Morning and welcome to the Covenant of the Torch Church Service, 31 July 2016. Also, like to welcome all those that are viewing by VOD from New York to Arizona to points farther west. At this time, let's go ahead and rise and go before our Lord in silent prayer. Trust in the Lord as Mount Zion, which cannot be moved, but abides forever. As the mountains surround Jerusalem, so the Lord surrounds his people, from this time forth and forever. Amen. Did you recite the Apostles' Creed? I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Universal Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. Sing hymn number 43. Father God, we
Thank you for this special day, Father, the Sabbath, Father. We dedicate to you, Father. We come into your house today, Father, to hear your word, Father, and to educate ourselves, Father, and to prepare our hearts, Father, to be ready for the end time. Father, we know that you're looking down upon us now, Father, and we ask that you will be with us from the beginning to the end of this service, Father. And Father, be with us in the Bible study this afternoon. Father, we thank you for the Redemptive Series books, Father, that give us a path, Father, that your people, Father, has started, Father, and we will finish at the end time, Father. It guides us and directs us, Father, in your path, Father, in your word. Father, we pray for our pastor today, Father, as he delivers this message, that it will touch each and every one, Father. Let us start a fire within us, Father. Let us truly hear with spiritual ears and a spiritual heart, Father. Let us receive this word in our hearts, Father, and let it grow, Father, and let it be fruitful, Father, and bear fruit for you. Father, we pray for our choir today, Father, that small in number, Father, but mighty in voice. Father, we pray for this congregation today, Father, for the many needs, Father. We know, Father, that you see those needs, Father. We sit here, and those watching by VOD, Father, touch them also. And Father, we pray for our soldiers that are in distant lands and around the world that give up their life sometimes, Father, to protect our freedom, Father, so we can hear your word today. And Father, lastly, we ask that you will watch over those running for president, Father, and those below, Father, that they will somehow, Father, rule using your word, Father, and using the Bible, Father, not their own goals and aspirations, Father. And Father, we just thank you today for the blessing of this church and this people that came here today, Father, expecting a blessing and ready to receive it. Father, we thank you. We raise you up and glorify your day in your precious name. In Jesus' name, amen. The text today is coming from Leviticus 8, verses 1 through 13. And the Koreans, I think, have a handout with those verses on it. Then the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, take Aaron and his sons with him, and the garments, and the anointing oil, and the bull of the sin offering, and the two rams, and the basket of unleavened bread. And assemble all the congregation at the doorway of the tent of meeting. So Moses did just as the Lord commanded him. When the congregation was assembled at the doorway of the tent of meeting, Moses said to the congregation, this is the thing which the Lord has commanded to do. Then Moses and Aaron and his sons came near and washed them with water. He put the tunic on him and girded him with a sash and clothed him with a robe, and put the ephod on him, and he girded him with the artistic band of the ephod, with which he tied it to him. He then placed the breastplate on him, and in the breastplate he put the Urim and the Thurim. He also placed a turban on his head, and on the turban at his front he placed the golden plate, the holy crown, just as the Lord had commanded Moses. Moses then took the anointing oil and anointed the tabernacle, all that was in it, and consecrated them. He sprinkled some of it on the altar 7 times and anointed the altar and its stand to consecrate them. Then he poured some of the anointing oil on Aaron's head and anointed him to consecrate him. Next, Moses had Aaron's sons come near and clothe them with tunics, and girded them with sashes and bound caps on them, just as the Lord had commanded. Amen. This time, the choir is going to come and give us a special.
All this free and faithfulness.
sent those 10 and under for a youth church. 10 and under, okay? This time, Pastor will come forward and give us a sermon on rights to become priest.
Good morning, church. Are you ready to receive a blessing of the Word of God this morning?
Amen.
Yes, you are. As you can see, summer continues to attack us and destroy us and seek to do all those things, but God is with the faithful, and God is always going to keep us. I believe that.
Amen.
First of all, I'd just like to say hallelujah for you overcoming the world and being here this morning, making your Father's house and the house of God your priority in life. And today, just as we read in the Word of God, I want to share the message of God's Word. I'm going to pray that the Covenant of the Torch people would really begin to hear the Word of God. You know, the Bible often compares the Word of God to trumpets. Compared to trumpets. And God, I believe, is calling this church, and I believe God more than that is calling you. He's calling you. He's asking you to come and study the Word of God, to be built up in the Word of God. God wants to build you up, because the more the Word you get, the more the light of God you get. The more the light of God you get, the more illumined you become. And the more illumined you become, the brighter you become. Amen? I believe God wants you to have a lot of faith, and He wants you to be a house of light. How many of you have ever went blueberry picking? I'm smiling at a few of my older sisters. They went picking blueberries, didn't they? How many of you have ever worked in an old farm picking peas or corn or anything like that? Have you ever done that in your life? Raise your hand. I see a few corn pickers around here, peanut pickers or whatever you want to call yourself. As a little boy, I used to make big money. They'd pay me $4 a day if I'd work from can to can. In the summer, can to can's a long time. Felt like a slave out there in that hot sun picking peas. Then that joker would want to complain about how I might not have picked the peas right, might have snapped them off a little bit somewhere in there, whatever. But he had this certain number we had to achieve and bring in, or we weren't a good pea picker. Are you good pea pickers this morning? Are you good cotton pickers? I'm picking on you. How many of you believe you're supposed to be working in the harvest of God?
Amen.
How many of you believe you're working in the house of God, the garden of God?
Amen.
Then where's the peas? Where's the blueberries? Where's the cotton? Every one of us is sitting here this morning empty-handed. Well, God, I tried, but oh, really? I don't want to get into that until this afternoon in the Bible study, but bear with me. All I'm asking you is the same thing God's asking you. Where are they? Where are you? Let's listen to the Word of God this morning. Be built up and be blessed. Amen? Amen. I pray that you might begin to pray in this church. I pray that you might begin to work fervently in this church. I pray that you might begin to do your part in the fulfillment of the administration of redemption history. How many of you think God's already quit working? He's not working anymore. How many of you think your life is all it can be? Your family is all it can be. The world is all it can be. Let me tell you what God wants. President Obama, Hillary Clinton, Howard Trump, or Billy Trump, whatever his name is, they cannot achieve the things that God wants accomplished. Amen? Amen. It takes God. It takes understanding the will of God and the Word of God to do the things we need to do. Amen. Jesus said, I always seek to do my Father's will. He didn't try to be politically correct. He did God's. He was trying to be correct in the eyes of God. Amen. So I just pray that you'll be blessed today. Today's text is going to prepare us to begin to look at the Old Testament and the New. The written scriptures, the written word, to begin to look at the open little book that you don't have in print, okay? A lot of you don't have it in print. Wouldn't it be nice if God could just open the Word of God and put it in print? I was Don't you wish the little book was in print? I believe redemption history books goes a long way to open that little book. How many of you bought some little, how many of you bought some redemption history books?
Amen.
How many of you like the books of redemption history?
Amen.
How many of you love your Father?
Amen.
How many of you love Jesus Christ?
Amen.
Then you need to do something. You need to pick some cotton, pick some peas. If I sent you out this morning, if I said, hey, yo, son, go, hey, women's ministry, let's all go out this Saturday, let's get some blueberries. Or if I said, let's make some blueberry pies and sell them. If you were supposed to do that next Saturday, how many blueberry pies could we cook if you didn't bring any blueberries back on Saturday evening? If I said, let's make some cucumber kimchi, how much cucumber kimchi could you make if you had to run down to Walmart to buy it because you didn't bring it? Let me tell you something. Don't ask God to do your harvest and don't ask God to do your shopping. Hallelujah.
Amen.
You need to do something. Amen. So, through this message today, we're going to look deep into the Word of God. How many believe we can do that? I want to show you how we do it. You know, Israel, just think for just a little moment. Adam had been thrown out of the Garden of Eden, and all of the history of redemption was about man's desire to get back in the Garden of Eden. How many believe the devil would like to go back to the Garden of Eden? When God kicked Adam out, you know what else he got out of the garden? Let me tell you something. You think of a heaven where the devil is reigning? Heaven is never heaven when the devil's in control. Your life is never truly blessed of God when the serpent's in control. You ever wondered why there were 42 camps of Israel wandering around? Every camp was an excuse. Every time they'd go someplace, God was trying to lead them back to Canaan. And just because they got to Canaan, they still had not arrived. Then they had to get to the right mountain. Then they had to get to the right house. Then they had to get into that house. It had three levels to get in that house. Amen? Couldn't just get to the outer court. Just couldn't go to the holy place. You had to go into the holies of holies. And then there was this little box. And in this little box, there was something else. And in that little box, what was in that little box? Jesus said, I'm the way, the truth, and life. A lot of people are still seeking for heaven. A lot of people still seeking for the kingdom of God. A lot of people still seeking for the Word. Let me tell you, stop making excuses and start studying. Can I get an amen this morning?
Amen.
I want you to get into that box. Hallelujah. Get into the book. Somebody said, duh, I don't understand that. You will. I want us to consider that the text this morning concerns something called the garments of Christ. It concerns the rights of, the garments of the priests. It concerns the rights of the priests. When I'm talking about the rights of the priests, I'm not talking about their human rights. I'm not talking about their benefits. It's spelled R-I-T-E-S. You know what that really represents? Spiritual, ceremonial rights. There's a rite of passage. Do you understand what I'm saying? A rite of passage. We're talking about how we get into that holy place. You remember I preached a few weeks ago, we're on theme here, church. Do you remember how we learned that we are a kingdom of priests? How many believe you're a kingdom of priests? Some of you might say it, but you're not there. You got to be in the kingdom to be a kingdom of priests. Hallelujah. How many believe you're a king? Not one more word in the house of God. How many believe you're a son of God? Not one word in the house of God, except the piano player. How many of you even know what it means to be a son of God? Think about this deep today, church. I can talk like this, can I? Can I? Is it right for me to talk that way? Let me tell you something. I'm not going to talk politics because you can disagree with me. I'm not talking about medicine because my doctor knows more about that than that. Let me tell you something. I know a little bit more than you do about the Word of God. Okay. Don't try to correct me on the Word. Believe the Word of God. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
So I challenge every member this morning to consider the importance of the priest these rites that I'm going to talk about, and later this week we'll study about the garments of the priest. We'll introduce the concepts today. Lastly, I've got a prayer. I have a dream. And I want you to have that vision and dream too. I want you to dream that you are a priest. I want you to dream that you're a king. I want you to believe and dream that you are sons of a living God. And I want you to believe that as a son of a living God, as a priest, as a king, you have a role to play in this church. You have a role to play in the kingdom of God. You have a role to play. You have a task to accomplish. And it's part. You will never know what your task in life is as long as you use your own pea brain to think about it. We need the Word of God. Amen. Don Setbecker saying amen, but he needs to be going duh too. This is profound, so please listen. These points that we're going to study today are very important. What are they important for? For gaining understanding of the whole Bible. The little book explains the whole Bible, just like Jesus on the road to Emmaus with those two men that were disappointed. Sometimes in life we're disappointed, but Jesus opens the little book to us. Amen. Only Jesus could do that. The Bible says it's important for us to gain understanding of our Bible, what our real life as Christians is supposed to be about. And last Wednesday night, we learned about the eschatology of our Father. What does eschatology mean? The end times. What is eschatology? We learned it's the last word. What is eschatology? We learned it's all about what? The revelation. What is eschatology? It's all about what our Father's doing. Our Father called us to be a part of the harvest. How do you believe you're part of the harvest our Father's trying to make? Don't come back this Sunday without some blueberries. Amen. Am I talking about blueberries or children of God? Hello, I'm talking to somebody this morning. Is God talking to you? Don't listen to this word as if it's the word of Pastor John. It's the word of God. Stop making excuses. Bring in the harvest. Hallelujah. Bring in the sheaves. Bring in the blueberries. Bring in the cucumbers. Bring in the whatever you want. You can't make kimchi without petchu. Amen? You can't make kimchi, cucumber kimchi without cucumbers. And you'll never have a church without people in it. Can I get an amen? Amen. Every one of you out there got a friend, a loved one. Hey, Jesus said, love your enemy enough to invite him to church. I don't want to get off on this tangent, but I want you to think about what I'm saying. The priest that we're going to be of Aaron, the priest, as we'll learn, even in the priesthood of Aaron, they had a very unique genealogy. They had very unique garments. You could not go to Belts and buy the garments of priest and Aaron. They did not have them on sale at Walmart's or JCPenney's. And once you put on these garments, no other garments would satisfy you. How many of you women, when you go out there to the store at Belts or whatever, just buy the first dress you see? How many of you women or men would go out and just put on the first thing you can find? You know you're lying. You won't do that. Women will wear out the men's feet. Their patience. Trying to find the right dress or the right garment. God wants us to find the right garments this morning. Amen?
Amen.
You said you're a king. You said you believe you're a priest. You said you believe if you're a priest and a king, that means you've got to have some word. What word? Prophesy means to tell about the end. Tell about what's going to happen in the future. You're not prophesying what you tell what happened in the past. Hallelujah. Priests had a very unique genealogy. Priests had a very unique uniform or garments. How many people know how many priests, there were high priests there were in the order of Aaron? How many priests were there? All my learning Korean ladies that's read book 6 ought to know. How many priests were there, church? High priest. 77. 77 priests. Why weren't there 76 or 77 or 78 or 79 or 80? God said there were 77 priests. Unique number, a unique people, unique men, and unique garments. Are you unique this morning? How many believe the line of Aaron was special? How would you have liked to have been, of all Israel, was land more important, or would you rather have been in the Levite tribe? See, the Levite was like Young and I or Pastor Beatty. We're not going to have a house. All we're going to have is the Word of God. What's more important, a house or the Word of God? Oh, you'd say that real easy. But I guarantee you, if they had an option on houses, you'd go out there and Donna go out there and try to find another house. When we study this genealogy, I pray that we will begin to receive joy in understanding the Word of God. How many of you think it's just sheer joy to memorize all 77 of those names of those high priests? If you're like me and you've got all-timers, some-timers, or whatever timers you got, I don't think you'll find much joy in memorizing 77 names. Most of you don't even know the names of the books of the Bible. They've been in the Bible for a couple thousand years. At least for a couple hundred in America. How many of you can stand up right now if I gave them a Bible quiz and handed out pen and paper and said, write down the books of the Bible in any order? We got kids in our church in Sunday school that can name them backwards. They can sing the song of the name of the priest. Do you think it's important? If God wants us to know there were 77 priests, how many of you believe those numbers in the Bible are important? We know they're important. But today, I don't want to talk about the genealogy. Today, I don't want to talk about just the garments. I don't want to just talk about the thing. I want to talk about what? The rites of passage, or the rites of the priest. Don't you wish the sermon was ending right now? Would it be good just to wait till next Sunday to find out what I'm going to talk about? When are we ever going to learn the Word of God? We do that. In 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 5 through 7, if you've got your sheets, follow with me. The Bible tells us that we are being built up. I'm sorry, it's not in that verse, is it? I gave you 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9, I think, but I didn't give you 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 5 through 7. You know what that verse says? It says, we are being built up as a spiritual house. We're being built up as spiritual stones. How many of you think, no, you're a stone? You ever heard of hard-hearted? God wants us to be a stone, a spiritual stone. How many understand Jesus Christ was a stone? And when you've got a lot of stones together, you can build a wall. When you've got a lot of stones together, you can build a house. Or you can build a tomb. I didn't come here to build a tomb. I came here to build a house of God. Amen?
Amen.
It takes all of us to be fit together. So I pray that as we share the message today, that you understand God wants to build a spiritual temple in you and with you. You're each stone. You're each a temple of God, but collectively we are the house of God. Amen? How many of you think that the work of the priest is important? How many of you believe the work you're doing at church is important? Which is more important, the work, Brother Jay, you do it out there at Fort Stewart, or the work you do here at church? Which one's more important? Brother Jay got it right, 100. He said the work he does right here is more important. How do you know that? Because God cannot lie. One has eternal retirement benefits and one has a temporal benefit. You might get 100% from the VA right now. You might retire, but that 100% ends 100% when you die. Hallelujah. Worship is the greatest part of the priest. Worship. What you're doing right now, and just coming to a building, is not worship. Singing songs is not worship. Jesus said true worship is worshiping the Father in spirit and truth. John 4:24. What I do want you to look at on your little sheets you've got there is 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9. Let's read that together. Gee, John. But you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for God's own possession. Stop. Does God possess you? That means you're God's slave. Brother James was singing a song about we're God's slave, and we were so happy to be God's slave. Are you happy to be a slave of God? Slaves don't have any rights, R-I-G-H-T-S, but they do have R-I-T-E-S, rights. There's a right that you have to go through, a ceremonial rite. Even worship is part of the ceremonial rite. And who leads worship? Just pastors? No. Deacons lead it. Pastors lead it. Praise team leaders lead it. Choir leads it. You're all a part of a worship of God. Let's read on. No, let's start all over again. 1 Peter 2, 9. Gee, John. But you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for God's own possession, that you may proclaim the excellencies of Him. That's your job. Who has called you out of darkness into His marvelous light. How did He call you? Out of darkness? Hello. How does God call us? Does God, hello? You ever heard, I heard a girl one time, she was a woman, talk about depression. I'd love to see God deliver you from the spirit of depression today. God, you can't play knock-knock jokes with God, is what she said. You know why? When you say, who's there? God said, I know. Amen? God knows. Can't play knock-knock jokes with God. God knows what you're thinking right now, what you're doing right now, and He sees your heart. Amen? He calls you out of darkness. That's your call. That's how He calls you. That's the trumpet. That's the word. You're chosen. You're royal. How many believe you're royal? You son of a gun, you can't, son of a daughter, you can't say I'm royal. God's word says you're royal if you come into the light. Here it says we're a chosen race. Here it says we're a royal priesthood. You're not just a priest, but you're a royal priest. Let me tell you something. You will never be royal until you're a member of the king's family. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
Don't just say you are. Believe that you are. Act like you are. There's two things that people in the Old Testament could not do at the same time. You know what that was? I'll say it one more time. In the Old Testament, there were two things that people could not do at the same time. That was to be a king and be a priest. Now, talk about king, who we want to talk about. Who's our first king we want to talk about in Israel?
Saul.
Brother Don got it right. You remember what Brother Saul, I call him brother because I believe somewhere along the line he might have been in the kingdom of God or part of the kingdom. Our brother Saul was king. One day, a man named Samuel, the prophet, the priest, the judge, he came and he was coming, and somehow Samuel delayed his coming just a little bit. You know, the Lord sometimes delays his coming to test us. Did you know that? And you know what happened? Brother Saul, King Saul, he said, I know what I'm going to do. Well, I'm the king. I'll just be a priest today. And God cursed him because of that. Who do you think delayed Samuel's coming? God was testing Saul. He said, Saul, let me tell you something. This is what Samuel probably told him in street language, footlocker training, as we call it in the army. He said, you know something, Saul? You're great. You even think you're royal, but you can't be a king and a priest. Say that with me. I can't be a king and a priest in the Old Testament. Oh, but in the New Testament, in eschatology, we can be royal. We can be a king and we can be a priest. Hallelujah. That's good news. Means you don't have to work at Walmarts anymore because you're... Oh, you got Micah jumping around over in front of you up here now. She's happy, I think. Listen, two things in the Old Testament you couldn't do at the same time. You could not be a king. You might be royal, but you couldn't be the priest too. And you couldn't, you had no right, R-I-G-H-T, to become the priest. You could be either a king or you could be a priest. If you tried to, even, the Bible said God would curse you. Would you want to do something that would curse you? No. You know, the devil wants to become a king. But he also wants to be a priest, and he goes around acting like a priest, like a prophet, but he lies. You know why he lies? Because he don't understand the Word of God. You know who you're working for when you don't understand the Word of God? You're working for the devil. It might take you 42 counts to find the land. But just getting into the land is not good enough. You've got to find the mountain. Finding the mountain is not good enough. You've got to find the box. To be kings and priests, then, is a double blessing. How many of you want to receive a double blessing in our God? It's a very special right, R-I-T-E. There's a rite of passage, there's a ceremonial rite thing you have to do to become a priest and a king, become royal. How many of you ever think you can be royal? How many of you think you were royal before you came to Jesus Christ? I think all of us were the same. We're all little sons of God, weren't we? No. Brother Derek, were you perfect before you came to Jesus Christ? Oh, no. I have to say the thing, oh, my God, no. Are you perfect now? You need to think about what I'm saying. It's a loaded question. Do you want to be perfect? Can you be perfect? Think about that, too. Let's see what the Word of God says. I pray that we can become, like Peter said, a royal priesthood. I pray that we become a holy nation. What is a nation? It is the kingdom of God. I'd love to see America become a holy nation. I'd love to see Israel become a holy nation because they had the right. I'd love to see Korea become a holy nation. Do you think everything in Korea is holy? Do you think everything in America is holy? Is everything in Israel holy? Do you think everything in your house is holy? How can it become holy? How can we say we're a part of a holy nation? There's only one kingdom that God wants us to be holy in. It's called the kingdom of God. Amen. I pray the U.S. could become a holy nation. And I don't want to get into politics, but how can we become holy? There's not a lot of gods. There's not a lot of ways. There's one way. There's one God. I pray that you would become a holy nation, a Christian nation. Why? Because I know that the Word of God becomes powerful and a nation becomes powerful when the two are together. Amen? When a nation has the Word of God, it becomes powerful. When you really have the Word of God, you become powerful. You become blessed. If I take this cup and I fill it with gold, what kind of a cup is it? If I painted it purple, it would mean that it's supposed to be royal. But if I just have a purple cup with nothing in it, is it royal? No, it's just purple, isn't it? Don't just be a cup that's purple on the outside. Our choir's even wearing purple. I believe it's purple. Y'all might say it's blue, but I'm calling it purple. I believe we're wearing garments on the outside, but there's a true garment we need to wear on the inside. Amen. What are our true colors? I'll say it again. I know that if the Word of God comes to a nation, that nation will begin to affect and influence and bless and bring blessing to other nations. The same is true with you when you truly become a child of the kingdom of God. When you truly become royal. When you stop saying, Pastor John, I can't be royal. I'm not smart enough. Pastor John, I can't be a priest because I'm not good looking enough. Pastor John, I can't because I'm too old. You're never too old to tell somebody Jesus loves them. That's the beginning. It's not the end, but it's the beginning. I want everybody to come and ask me for a copy of the plan of salvation. And start telling somebody, the first thing people have got to do to come to this word is learn how to get saved. Amen? It's real. It's not something. There's a ceremonial passage, a ceremonial rite they have to go to come to Christ. Listen carefully. Abraham was only one man. You're only one. I'm only one pastor. But he became a nation. Even Ishmael was only one man, yet he became a nation. Cain was only one man, but he became a nation. The genealogy you're of is important, isn't it? Amen. Why did God give us the right to become such a precious people and a precious nation? If we're precious people, that means this little church is precious. Amen?
Amen.
If we're precious people, God didn't just call us precious, just give us an honorable title. Some people think, so I'm a Christian. In spite of what they do, they say, I'm a Christian. In spite of what they believe, they say, I'm a Christian. They went through the rite of passage, but they've never passed anything. Why did God give you the glorious right and the glorious title to be called a priest? Why did God give us the right to be called the sons of God? Why did God give us the right, I'm talking about R-I-G-H-T right now, to be called a priest, a king, royal priesthood, son of God? You know why God's doing that? Because God is making you into a priest. That's what God wants to do. God creates priests, Brother Steve, by giving them his blessing and giving them his word. Amen. Amen. God is making you, God is making me into a priest by proclaiming his marvelous life to us. The Bible says in John chapter 1, verse 4 to 5, not on your sheets, put in your heart. The light has shined in the darkness, but even the priest then did not understand it. I wonder why. The word of God is being proclaimed right now, and I wonder why you don't get it. What shall we proclaim? What does God want us to proclaim? Jesus wanted to proclaim the gospel, the good news, the word, the way to the mountain of God had come, the way to the Father had come, the way to get inside the little box, the way to get inside the little book, the way to get inside the kingdom. What shall we proclaim? I'll tell you what we're supposed to proclaim. The open book. Revelations 5, 1 through 5 talks about a book that had a seal that John was weeping. And I asked you a long time ago, how many times have you wept because you don't understand the word of God? Don't just weep in them from emotions. Weep in your heart because you really, really, really want to study and you really, really, really want to know. What makes a doctor a good doctor? You better hope he knows what he's doing. Amen. What makes a good pea picker a good pea picker? What makes a good blueberry picker a good blueberry picker? What makes an Adam in the garden of God a good Adam? You have to reap a harvest. You have to have good fruit. Do you really think God's word is any different than the world? The world explains the word of God. We're without excuse. Romans 1, 19 through 24 tells us that. We're without excuse. Revelation 5, 5 through 7 tells us what we have to do. How many believe we've been given an awesome word? Hello, somebody talk to me out there. This is not rhetorical. Why? Do you believe you've been given an awesome word? Do you believe that God has shown his awesome light to you? Then God wants you to come out of darkness. God wants you to come out of darkness. God wants you to come out of darkness, chaos, and a sin-filled world, a world covered by waters of fallen man and sin, and come into a world where there are no fallen waters. There is no sea. Revelation 21 talks about a place like that. God creates it by his
word.
So God says his word is awesome, his light is awesome, and God is saying, listen to me. You seen that picture of Uncle Sam on American post boards when I went to the Army? I looked at the poster and I seen a picture of Uncle Sam. I've never seen Uncle Sam. You know, back in those days, I was a little country boy. I really thought there was somebody called Uncle Sam. And he had a finger pointed and said, I want you. And he got me. Let me tell you the other good news. God wants you.
Amen.
Join his army. He's your uncle. He's your father. He's your King of Kings and Lord of Lords. He's our high priest. He is the Word of God, and he wants you. God says, I want you to become my royal priest. Brother Derek, do you believe God wants you to become a royal priest? He doesn't want us to be a royal pain in the butt. He wants us to become royal priests. Don't be a pain in the butt to somebody, but be a blessing to somebody. Amen?
Amen.
In the Old Testament, it was Aaron and his sons that were qualified to become priests. All tribes of Israel could not become priests. Only the tribe of Aaron. Huh? Only the Levites. Listen carefully. Listen carefully. How many of you think you're the sharpest knife in the kitchen drawer? How many of you are the best cooks that we have in a covenant church? How many of you graduated Harvard? Do you think you have to graduate Harvard to be royal in the kingdom of God? Did you know Harvard, Yale could take you further away from the kingdom of God than you ever dreamed of? I'd rather have a diploma hanging on that says, I read my Bible. I understand my Bible. I'm a king. Put that on your wall instead of a graduation from Harvard. Hallelujah. Somebody out there shouting amen. Maybe on BOD. I don't know. I hear it in the spirit right now. Other people could not be priests no matter how rich they were, no matter how smart they were. It doesn't matter if the tribe of Benjamin or the tribe of this Ben, whatever the tribe, it doesn't matter how powerful their daddy became, how famous their grandfather was. They could not become priests. And you could not become a king unless you come from the tribe of Judah. Hello. But we can be priests and kings. That's good news. We can be royal. That's good news. So listen, it did not matter how smart you were. It didn't matter how much word you knew. A lot of people think they know a lot of word. They want to tell me how to teach the word of God. I'm anointed by God. Do you understand that? That means sometimes the Holy Ghost inspires me. Sometimes the Word of God blesses me. And when it blesses me, I want to bless you. It's not my word. I'm a copy of a copy of a copy of a copy. But I'm a copy of the original. Hallelujah.
Amen.
It did not matter how smart they were, how great they were, anything else. It did not matter what kind of person they had. See, some people think preachers today need to be blonde-headed, blue-eyed, and 6'2". Wear beautiful suits. What is that famous suit company? Armani or whatever that is. I don't even know about rich suits. I don't have no expensive suits. I don't have any Gucci bags either. But the garments I wear at church are garments my father gave me. And any other garment does not feel right. And if you're wearing something today, you can buy it belts. If you're wearing something you can buy in the world, you're putting on the wrong garments. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Come on, church. My father done wrote these books for us. We need to read them. Some people would, before they buy a redemption history book or a Bible, if you want to be a Gideon, be a Gideon. If you want to be a child of the kingdom, I believe you need to buy a redemption history book. Amen? You know what? You go spend more on a hamburger than you will on God. You'll spend more at McDonald's for lunch than you will at the church. You ought to be ashamed of yourself. Not before me. Nobody else knows what you're doing, but God does. You need to read tonight Luke chapter 19, And you need to read from chapter 16, verses 19 to about verse 25 or 26, and you get the message. That poor man went to heaven to the bosom of Abraham. He was poor, but he didn't have no money to buy his way. But he went there. But that rich man was laying in the grave. He said, I didn't believe. I spent all my money on me. I spent all my money on what I wanted to do. And I didn't spend any money on Jesus. He said, I can't get a, let somebody dip my tongue with some water. Abraham said, no. I can't send someone to you. This was Jesus' parable, but it was also a great, great, great truth. Then he turns and he said, well, Jesus, God, Abraham, send Lazarus to cool off my tongue. I'm in torment in my grave. Instantaneously, he was in torment. He said, I'm sorry, Lord, I want to repent. He probably said, I repent 100,000 million times. It doesn't matter how many times you say, I repent when you're in the grave. It doesn't matter how many times you lie and say you repent. It doesn't matter how many times you lie and say, I give my heart to Jesus. Give it to him. Hallelujah. Give it to him. Be a living sacrifice for the Lord. You're royal if you do. You're rich if you do. You're a priest if you do. You're a son of God if you do. Jesus was a son of God, but he gave his life for you and for me. That's good news. You know what you need to do today? Go home and be somebody's good news. Maybe it's your wife, your children, your brothers, your sisters, your aunts, your cousins. I don't care. Jesus said if it's your enemies, you can teach them too. Don't go blueberry picking this Saturday and come back Sunday with no blueberries. Amen? I want you to bring some cucumbers to the house of God. Now, please don't go out and get a bunch of cucumbers and bring them to the church Saturday. I ain't talking about cucumbers. And don't go out there and get no green. I don't want no green to grind that I got to make biscuits with. They sell it at Walmart. It's called flour. Pastor, I'm not ready. It doesn't matter how smart you are. Brother Derek out there is probably one of the better looking men in this church. I went under a walk door. Is people laughing? I don't laugh about that. I'm serious. And he can walk around that lap out there in Liberty County. Got a little nice little park. Me and Barry used to try to make three or four, and after a while we got arthritis in our knees so bad we had to have operations. He didn't have to have anything. He just kept on walking. But I noticed why he kept on walking. He was so good looking, every now and then a girl would stop him and talk to him. Or vice versa. I'm not sure which one that was. Maybe they saw that purple robe you wear. Maybe they thought that you're a priest and a king and you're a son of God, Brother Roland. I believe that. I'm going to think positive, okay? None of these things matter, church. What matters is what kind of priest are you? Do you have light? Do you have the Word of God? It doesn't matter if I got 500 here or if I've got 5 here. What matters is what is this preacher teaching? No. What matters is what are you hearing? That's what matters. Amen?
Amen.
You need to hear the Word of God. Unless you were a Jew, unless you were of Aaron's line, if Aaron was not your father, your great-grandfather, you could never become a priest. The good news is today, God needs to become your father. Amen? If God's your father, you're not a son of a gun anymore. You are good looking. You are handsome. You are the sharpest knife in the drawer. You got the sharpest sword because you have the sword of the Word and the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. How many of you are glad you came to church today?
Amen.
I'm glad you came too. It's a bit more. You know what? God's even gladder than I am. How many of you going to come back with cucumbers this next Sunday? Come back with me some blueberries. I like blueberries too because some people know how to take that blueberry and mix it with something that makes it pretty good. I'm not going to say what that is, but it turns out maybe it's Kool-Aid. I don't know. Why Couldn't they become priests? Why couldn't all those rich people in Jerusalem become priests? Because they weren't in the line of Aaron. What was the problem? Their genealogy. Bingo! How many of you understand that Genesis, how many of you understand that redemption history starts with a key? And the key is called Genesis genealogies. The second book is called The Forgotten Encounter. I believe we've forgotten the encounter we need to belong to, or the genealogy we need to belong to, and we need to have another encounter with Jesus Christ. Amen. You want to have a second harvest? Don't look for me to give you some bread and turkeys out of the church. Don't come to church for what you can get. Come to the church for the Word of God. Amen. In the Old Testament, only the sons of Aaron became priests. In the New Testament, the Bible says only the sons of God can become priests. You know how you become a son of God? I tell you, hey, there's a rite of passage. John chapter 10 tells us, verse 34 and 35, it says it's by. Jesus said, why are you troubled by what I've taught you? Is it not said in the scriptures, those to whom the word of God comes are sons of God? Are you a son of God? You're not unless the word of God has come to you. Now, the Bible can come to you, but if it's sealed, you don't have the word of God. You can come to church, and you're still not a son of God. I can sleep in a garage and go nothing all day long, but I'm never going to turn into a motorcycle. I can sleep in a doghouse and bark, but I'll never become a dog. I might smell like one, but I'll never become one. If you want to become a child of dog, let the word come to you. Amen. Not everyone becomes priest, but those who can call God their Father. You know how we call Him Father? We say, Abba, Father. Abba, Father. We'll read these, and I'm going to conclude right here. Romans chapter 8, verse 15, and Galatians chapter 4, verse 5. So I don't cheat. So you know you're not cheated. Won't you turn to those in your Bible? Wouldn't it be nice to read your Bible? You got those books memorized, right? Romans chapter 8, verse 15. Romans 8, 15, please find it. Has everyone found it?
Amen.
Amen. Will somebody read that for me? Can I do that? Will somebody read it for me?
Romans 8, verse 15 says, for you did not receive the spirit of bondage again to fear, but you received the spirit of adoption by whom we cry out, Abba, Father.
Abba, Father.
Amen.
Or Abba, Daddy. Can you talk to me? Can you say by the Spirit that your Father is God? If you don't have the Spirit, you could say it, but you're really not being honest about it, and God knows it. Let's look at the last one, Galatians 4, verse 5. Let's read that. Galatians 4, verse 5. By which we cry, Abba, Father. Okay. John 10, 35 and 36, like I said, says, to those to whom the word of God comes, these shall be called the sons of God. Has the word of God come to you, church? I didn't say if you went to Sears or to the Bible bookstore and bought a Bible. I asked you, has the word of God come to you? If it has, would you even know it? 1 Corinthians 2, 7 through 14 says it's only by the Spirit that you will understand the deep things of God's Word. What I'm talking about today, and I'm going to talk about this afternoon, are deep things in the Word of God. God's calling you again. God's calling you. God's calling you. Do you believe that? How's He calling you? We learned we're called out of darkness into His marvelous light. God called Israel to come out of Egypt. That was a land of darkness. He wanted to go to Canaan, which is a land of understanding and light. They're still there, and they're still not there. You know why? Brother D, they never found the little box. You know what? God, the little box that was in Israel, God took it away. Because it's not a little box you need to find. It's Jesus Christ. And they didn't find Jesus Christ either. So God says, you got to find the little box. That little man. That little manna. That little word. When? In the second coming. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much that you've given us, Father. Father, a beginning of the understanding of our right of passage to become your priest, to become kings. Not just a priest, Father, and not just a king, but both of them, Father. And not just priests or kings, Father, but we have a right to be called the sons of God. May we be good priests, good kings, good sons. In Jesus' name, amen.
All right, let's go ahead and sing hymn number 259. Cheerful heart, Father, knowing it's to expand your kingdom, Father, and give to your word, Father, this precious word, Father. And Father, we just thank you and we lift you up and glorify you today, Father. And all that you bless us with in our lives. In your precious name we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you. Father God, we know that you've seen the heart, Father. You've seen the joy in the hearts that gave this morning, Father. Father, we ask that you will continue to bless us, Father, as we go forward in this church. And Father, we now present these tithes and offerings to you, Father. We pray that you will accept them, Father, with a love in your heart, the same as the love that gave you, Father. And Father, we ask you to give us guidance and direction, Father. Show us a path that you would have us take, Father. For the end time is near, Father, and we need to be ready. Father, we just thank you, Father, and as we present these to you today, Father, we know that you will multiply them tenfold, Father, a hundredfold for this church. We thank you, Father, and give you the glory today, Father, in your precious name, in Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
We've got a couple of announcements here. Just a reminder, when you come here on Sunday morning, just plan on staying here most of the day. A lot of you would like to take off after the service or after fellowship, but stick around for the Bible studies, okay? Also, let's start. We have a whole office in there full of books that we need to get out into the hands of the people that maybe we're witnessing to or whatever. We need to start getting those off the shelves. They're not doing any good in the office. We need to get them into the hands of those that can read them. We need to pray that our Wednesday night service increases, those that come. Wednesday night is an important part of our service because we pray for those in need here. And we really get into deep prayer, into a deeper Bible study than we do on Sundays. Okay? Remember, prayer is the way that we sow the seeds for answers for not only our problems, but others' problems.
I just wanted to kind of give you a little bit of good news and update on what's going on. As I initially was programming to go to Korea tomorrow, in fact, I should have already been gone, but because of some announcements in Seoul and phone calls and what have you, and development of things for the seminary, I was basically told to attend some meetings with tracts that accredits the seminaries and what have you, international. So I'll be going up to down to Florida this week, and I'll also be going up to Forest, Virginia. I don't even know where that is. It's so funny. I live on Forest Street. I'm going to Forest, Virginia. But I got to go up there for an all-day convention and interview for our application for accreditation for the Barrett Seminary. That's good news, isn't it?
Amen.
Some of you who've been through Barrett before are going to have your degrees formally accredited in the future. So please think about that and thank God for it. It's a blessing. I'd like to ask Brother Pastor Beatty and his precious wife, she's an elder, she's also a psalmist because he's a pastor. Would you please stand up in our audience for just a minute? I want everybody to see him and know who he is. He is coming here to work with us in the seminary. And we need to welcome him. He's also going to become like the associate pastor with his church as well. Brother Beatty, Pastor Beatty, and his beloved wife has come here as volunteers, sacrificing their lives. And I welcome them. I welcome their help. And I believe great things are about to happen in Hinesville. Amen.
Amen.
Pastor Beatty is an awesome teacher. He's a professor at seminary. And he's going to begin to do great, great, great things through Barrett Seminary. And if you love the Lord, you've got to say amen about all that. That ought to get you excited. I also wanted to tell you that I'm going to reluctantly be absent. I hate to be absent from the house of the Lord. But it also gives occasion for me to invite Pastor Beatty to speak. And this coming Sunday, next Sunday, he will be the honoring us by speaking a precious word to you, and I'm sure it'll be a blessing and a challenge. So let's not miss church. Let's invite somebody to church like he's Dr. Lee coming to this church to speak one time. Amen?
Amen.
Maybe you'll speak millions of times before it's all over with. But invite somebody to church. Don't bring cucumbers. Don't bring flour. Bring somebody to church. Amen?
Amen.
Tell them about the Lord. Hallelujah. You going to remain for Bible study? I pray you do. Now, I know we have people in our church that love to smoke. You know what? I love you and God loves you. You know, and smoking might not be good for you, but read and find it in your Bible where it says it's a sin. Just not there. And if it ain't in the Word of God, I don't preach it. Amen. I would that you not hurt yourself. I believe smoking gives you cancer. Smoke will make you age and wrinkle faster. Look at me. But the Word of God will make you younger, handsomer, cuter, smarter, and sharper. Amen?
Amen.
So you know what I'm going to do? I think I'm going to create some spiritual butt cans out back where you can step back there, relax, and take a smoke break and be happy. And then you can stay for the Word of God. Which is more important, a cigarette or the Word of God?
Word of God.
Would you feel comfortable? You ought to. You know what? There's no racetrack. There's no nothing. There's no football game. There's no Super Bowl. There's no golf game. There's nothing more important than the Word of God. Amen?
Amen.
The Lord's Day needs to be the Lord's Day. And I think I do the best on Sunday afternoon after I've eaten good food. Amen?
Amen.
Now I want to talk about Wednesday night for just a minute, too. Some of you little rascals wouldn't show up for Wednesday night for nothing. You know why I call you rascals? You're like the little rascals. You know where you ought to be, but you're a rascal and you're not here. You need to be praying for your loved ones. You say, Pastor, well, I'm healthy. I don't need to pray. You better watch out. You need to be sowing seeds of prayer. You'll never have a harvest to reap if you don't sow something. I can never have blueberries unless I plant a blueberry tree. I can never get cucumbers, amen, Clemson, if I don't plant cucumber seeds. If you want to invite somebody to church, you've got to start sowing the Word of God in them. But you know what you do? You come to church on Wednesday nights and you pray for your nation. You pray for President Obama, Hillary, pray for Trump. Yes, my God, pray for Trump too, okay? Let's pray. But you know what? Who I want to be president in command? God, Jesus Christ. That's what I want. That's what I want. And I just cannot stop but tell you this before I go. I'm going to continue this afternoon. I would that the Korean ladies would bring their little notes and be in here for Bible study this afternoon. It's a present little message, but I'm getting a shake in the head. They'd rather go watch a video. And my wife says that. She always does that. She's anti-Christ. No, I mean, she's anti-Pastor John. Listen carefully, church. Our Father said we don't just have outer garments. We have inner garments. He gave a message that says, you never take the new garments of God and put them over your old garments. What are your old garments? Your selfishness, your pride, your stubbornness, your worldliness, all of those things. See, we try to become Christians. We say, I just accept Jesus, and we think we can just put a brand new suit on over our old garments. No. Aaron had, and Moses had to wash Aaron in them. Can you imagine a high priest washing somebody? Jesus Christ washed his disciples' feet. That's pretty low, isn't it? We need to change our inner garments, too. The winter garments are one you think that nobody sees. Let me tell you something. God sees them, and God smells them. When you come to church, don't just take a bath, but take a real bath in the Word of God. Ephesians 5:26 tells us to wash ourselves in the Word of God because Jesus washed us with his blood. Let's stand. Let's sing hymn number 6 or 2. Yes. Your blessings be upon them. In your name, and in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. All God's children said,